Right, let's hear what you have to say about old people. I was just reading an interesting series of debates that took place at the EAU on controversies in bladder cancer. So much of stuff is going on in controversies that I think there's nothing new, frankly, if you ask me. There's a lot of tweet. Everybody has given his viewpoint, another guy gives his viewpoint. And ultimately, what I feel is between the surgeon and the patient, what the surgeon is capable of doing and what is good in his hand. And nothing more. He feels one fellow says you should do this, another guy says you do this. Quote some reference and evidence for and against one or the other. There's no clear guidelines at all on this. So let's hear what you have to say.
So I will be presenting on MIBC and octogenarians, management options. Starting with epidemiology, bladder cancer is an age-associated malignancy with a median age at diagnosis of 73 years. And individuals aged 75 to 84 years account for the largest percentage, that is 30% of new cases. It's the fourth leading cause of cancer-related death among men aged 80 and older. And historically, over 80% of deaths from bladder cancer occur in people who are age of 65. So the problem statement is, more than half of the patients under the age of 60 had potentially curative treatments, such as surgery or radiotherapy. A third of patients in their 70s and only of 12% of patients over 80 were given such procedures. The term elderly refers to an advanced chronological age, perhaps most important factor.
You have got it from which source? Because from whatever we see, do you think it fits into us? Our patients are mostly in their 60s.
Ma'am, actually, Indian data, I searched for the Indian data. The data were only in the Tata Memorial Center, 2013 only. And in that only they have presented, they have not given the epidemiological demographic data. They have just given what are the types of patients they have presented with and what are the management options they have given. And the data was only of Tata Memorial Center. One data was of SGPGI, but it was also of old data. These are the recent data which has been taken from SEER, S-E-E-R registry.
Okay, okay.
You see, one of the problems is that all the data that we get and all the data we use, everything that we talk about is all gained from Western data, Europe and West and America. So we have to take everything with big, big pinches of salt for our own selves. While we know that these are some of the rules of the game there, it may not apply here. And there are many patients here who are of totally different milieu. Everything is very different. So I think we are really stuck with the fact that we don't know what to do and we just fall back on somebody else's data. Typical of what's happening in our medical world in India. Anyway, we understand that this is a contentious issue.
Yes, sir. The term elderly refers to an advanced chronological age. Perhaps more important factors in determining treatment decisions are the functional status and associated comorbidities of the individual patient. A fit elderly patient, no matter what is his age, should be considered for aggressive interventions for bladder cancer, while those with significant health issues may not benefit. Patients who are fit have no significant functional impairments and have no comorbidities. What are frail? Frail patients demonstrate dependence in basic functional tasks, significantly impaired mobility, significant comorbidities, or at least one significant geriatric syndrome, such as fall. So there is a new approach towards the management of geriatrics oncology. In that, the new approach is multidisciplinary bladder cancer clinic. This involves many different departments, such as surgical, medical, and radiation oncology, internal medicine, physical therapy, and nutrition. The advantages are that the patients we can discuss with a urologic or radiation oncologist in addition to subsequent medical oncologist evaluation to make an appropriate treatment decision. So what are the various assessment scales? One of the most commonly used assessment scales in geriatric is comprehensive geriatric assessment. This assesses many areas of health, including function, comorbidities, socioeconomics, cognition, emotion, medications, nutrition, dementia, fall risk, etc. This tool has been utilized and validated, showing its effectiveness in identifying the true health status of these patients. This scale is a newer scale, and it is being used in approximately every article which is being published on geriatric oncology.
Can I just interrupt for a minute? What is happening is that there is no comprehensive geriatric sort of setup in many places.
Yes, sir.
These patients have multiple medical problems. So the cardiologist sees the cardiac point of view only. He doesn't see the whole thing. The neurologist sees only the brain. The colorectal fellow only sees the colon. So a comprehensive geriatric assessment is never made. And each fellow, if you look at the drug sheets of many of these patients who are elderly, you will find that the cardiologist is given a lot of drugs, the other fellows given, there is drug interaction, and you know, the drug doses are different. So it's a terrible thing. I don't know, does KEM have a geriatric department? They must be having one now. Do you have a department of geriatrics, and do medical students go through geriatrics in your hospital?
No, sir. I don't know.
But the thing is that patients are not referred to geriatricians. The cardiologist will only see the patient. He will not refer to geriatricians. So there's a big problem here in our country also. You know, they are going from pillar to post with all their files. Each patient has got four different files visiting four different consultants. So it's a big problem trying to decide what is the most appropriate treatment for them. But this is very, very important. A geriatric assessment is absolutely mandatory in patients who are going to have surgery like this. We just do eyeballing, but there are very clear methods by which a patient can be assessed. Their cognitive behavior, their brain function, everything is very important. So, just carry on.
Yes, there is another scale, Edmonston Frail Scale, and different various scales are there, like preoperative assessment in elderly cancer patients, ADL, CIRSG, IADL, G8, and Flemish version of the triage risk screening tools. So the management options. Three options should be discussed with every older patient who presents with invasive localized bladder cancer. That is observation with symptom management alone, radiation therapy with or without concomitant chemotherapy, radical cystectomy with or without chemotherapy. So starting from observation. Advantages. It avoids the potential risk and side effects associated with treatment with the implicit hope, expectation that the patient will die of another illness. Disadvantages. The local symptoms may include bleeding, frequency and urgency, incontinence, bladder pain, outlet obstruction, and upper tract obstruction. Unfortunately, once local symptoms become problematic, they often are refractory to the treatment, and the patient may require multiple trips to the emergency department, hospital admission, transfusions, and painful procedures.
This is very important, this last line that you said. You see, the problem with the bladder cancer is hematuria and clot retention.
Yes, sir.
And as long as that bladder remains, as long as the tumors remains, this is an endless saga. And these older people, huge trips, and this last paragraph, very important. At each point, they get worse and worse. So that small window of opportunity that they had earlier on to do something is lost. That is a big problem here. It's a very difficult decision. Very difficult.
Yes, sir.
Okay, next slide.
Thus, a patient who is believed to have a 2-year life expectancy and is likely to survive the surgery is often best treated with definitive therapy, either with cystectomy or radiation. It is so because the natural course of MIBC is that it's within 2 years that the patient suffers significant morbidity and die of disease within 2 years of diagnosis. Hence, a patient who is having a 2-year life expectancy and is likely to survive the surgery is often best treated with definitive therapy. Coming to the radical cystectomy, it is associated with the highest survival rates as compared to other treatment strategies. In a series from Memorial Sloan Kettering studying cystectomy in octogenarians, radical cystectomy in older patients with bladder cancer provided similar disease control and survival outcomes with risk of high-grade perioperative morbidity, which is comparable to those in younger patients, supporting that chronological age per se is not a factor to exclude patients from potential curative therapy. Uh, the overall cure rate is about 70% at 5 years if the organ is confined on final pathology, and if there is metastasis, it is about 30%. Morbidity and complications of radical cystectomy. Most studies report that radical cystectomy is safe in octogenarians. Overall mortality rate is 4%. Approximately 30% of patients suffering from some type of complication, and about 5 to 10% suffer from high-grade complications. So open versus lap versus robotic radical cystectomy. A randomized trial at Memorial Sloan Kettering failed to identify a large advantage of robotic-assisted techniques over standard open surgery for patients undergoing radical cystectomy or pelvic lymph node dissection. Similar 90-day complication rates, hospital stay, pathological outcomes, and 3 to 6 months quality of life outcomes were observed, regardless of the surgical technique. A 2014 meta-analysis looking at 16 small prospective and retrospective studies reported decreased intraoperative blood loss, less narcotic analgesic requirement, and longer operative time in laparoscopic versus open radical cystectomy. So there is no benefit in overall survival or cancer-free survival in either of the approaches. There is a decreased intraoperative blood loss, less narcotic analgesic requirement, longer operative time in laparoscopic than that of.
See, you made a very important statement, and that is that none of these newer techniques have got any survival advantage in cancer. You know, all these techniques are used basically for cancer.
Yes, sir.
By the way, they are used for pyeloplasty and all those things, but they have been primarily designed for use in cancer. And everybody feels, especially the lay public feels, that by doing this operation, that they are going to live longer. And that is being shown by large studies, both in Australia from the prostate cancer, radical prostatectomy group, and this Memorial Sloan. So the advantage is only buying it out. I can talk you out of this. It's all how the way you speak to a patient and how you convince him for this or the other. You think, oh, right, I've got a robot, so therefore I can do it this way. But what is important is there's no doubt about the fact that the pain is less, the post-operative stay is less, but the complications are the same. You see, all the things are the same.
Sir, don't you think maybe it is a speculation, but in an older age group, pneumoperitoneum would cause more problems with the chest rather than an open surgery?
That is what we feel, that, you know, especially the cystectomies, 6 to 8 hours of pneumoperitoneum on their cardiac reserve, on their lung reserve, can have a problem because it's all done with steep Trendelenburg. Very steep Trendelenburg, 15 degrees is huge. You see the patients for all these operations. So I'm actually quite impressed that the anesthetists have been able to manage these patients so well and get a, but, you know, the meat is different, the quality is different, everything is different. We are doing these operations in our own country. We have got patients not in the same age, but in the 60s to 70s, where they are doing a large number of these cystectomies in all India now, you know, but some of them are doing totally intracorporeal, somebody are doing cystectomy one and extracorporeal the conduit. So whatever it is, there is still a morbidity. You can't run away from it. You'll be fooling yourself if I do it this way or the other way. So this slide is very important to understand that it's not the machine that is doing everything. It's a disease that we're dealing with. It's a dirty disease. Okay.
Actually, sir, I have this slide from where which I have taken. Actually, they have compared 10 complications in between open laparoscopic and robotic. And okay. They have mentioned that lung complications are more in open surgery than that of laparoscopic or robotic.
Oh, very interesting.
Yes, sir.
Because of the pain, I think. I think it's only because of the pain factor. You see, a larger incision, maybe there's more of handling. There's no doubt that if you go into an abdomen where laparoscopic surgery has been done before, there's no hardly anything at all there. Especially these DBFs and all that we do, which are done after laparoscopy, there are no adhesions there. It's very clean. Whereas in open surgery, definitely the tissue planes are disturbed much more. Than, I think it's because of the pain factor. It's not anything else.
Yes.
I don't know whether that's what it is. It's, you know, the lung movements get less because of the pain. So,
ileal condu versus cutaneous ureterostomy versus continent diversion. Horowitz et al. In Toronto analyzed the impact of patients' age following radical cystectomy by subdividing 605 patients into four age groups. Results of this study showed that the rate of neobladder and continent cutaneous diversion use decreased with increasing age. But a recent review of 21 studies compare at least one quality of life metric between the patient who received an IC or neobladder following radical cystectomy. 16 studies reported no difference in quality of life. 4 reported improved quality of life with neobladder, and 1 reported better quality of life with ileal condu.
There is I was just listening to some of the EUA debates on this, and there was one debate on ileal conduit versus neobladder. In a patient who is about 60 years old, they gave the case history, and 2 people were debating, one guy from England and one guy from Germany. The German guy was debating for neobladder. But what is interesting, the guy from England who was for ileal conduit looked at it from the point of view of forget the GFR, the EGFR of 60, that was a different matter altogether. But what he brought out was the quality of life of this lady, her survival is likely to be 20 years on the case basis, 20 years survival. She's already this age. When she comes of that age, she's going to have a lot of other medical geriatric comorbidities like Alzheimer's, she can have falls, she can have cognitive impairment. And at that point in time, she will have incontinence from her neobladder. Whereas the conduit will be safe for her. She will be just putting the bag and that's it. So he argued in favor of that. I thought that is a very nice argument. I've never heard of that argument before, where somebody looks at 20 years down the track and says, this guy can have this problem. Simply because that's known. We know that the longer the people are living, and in those countries, these conditions are very important. We are seeing a lot of them here. Many years ago, we were told in India that multiple sclerosis did not exist. When I went to England, that was the first time I actually saw multiple sclerosis. Now we see so many cases of MS. Maybe we didn't know what they were. They didn't exist or what. But now we know there are MS, that people are treating them. So it's there. I mean, these conditions are there. Just that we are inundated with so many other issues, infective diseases which are overriding everything else. Diarrhea, dysentery, and infections, TB, fungus, all that. Yeah? So anyway.
Yes,
I'm just sharing some because this is an important issue, and the EAU has discussed this in the last, just the 2021 year, just concluded.
Yes. So elderly patients may not be able to preserve homeostasis after a continent diversion. Thus, it is important the appropriateness of the patient which are selected for this. Siddiqui and Izawa reported that the diversion of choice for elderly patient and those with reduced renal function following radical cystectomy is an ileal condu. IC has been found to pose the least metabolic changes with excellent quality of life reported by the patient. Longo et al. Reported that if you use cutaneous ureterostomy, it is a valid alternative to ileal condu in an elderly patient with comorbidities or perioperative complications without significant impairment to their quality of life. Patients undergoing ileal condu had longer operating times, higher estimated blood loss, and need for intensive care monitoring than that of cutaneous ureterostomy. And they are having a longer time for drain removal and length of hospital stay. Elderly patients undergo continent urinary diversion with neobladder less often than younger patients. They have slower resumption of continence after surgery and higher rates of stress incontinence.
One of the things we are taught is that you cannot do a cutaneous ureterostomy in an undilated ureter.
Yes, sir.
But that is now not really valid because you can use certain skin flap techniques and bring this ureter out and make sure it's preserving its blood supply and make sure that you have the skin flap techniques which will prevent the stenosis. It's mainly bringing the ureter and its blood supply that causes the problem. I think that's what is causing the stenosis rather than actually just bringing it out of the skin. And the dilated ureter is much thicker and easier to sort of unfold into a bag and put a device which is this. I think it was blood supply which was a problem for the ureter, and that's why this operation fell into disrepute. This is a very good way of actually handling without any bowel thing. You just correct it and leave it, that's all. Okay.
Partial cystectomy is appealing in this age group because it has less morbidity but is only effective in rare cases. Like when an isolated tumor is present near the dome of the bladder, there are no CIS changes, no multifocality, adequate bladder capacity. five year overall and cancer specific specific survival and recurrence free survivors are 67, 87 and 39% respectively. Coming to the radiation therapy advantages, avoidance of morbidity of surgery and the requirement for a urostomy. Radiation alone can be used to palliate local disease associated symptoms such as hematuria, dysuria or frequency. It is most effective when combined with chemotherapy, and the most common regimens are either weekly cisplatin or 5-fluorouracil and mitomycin C with radiotherapy for patients who are ineligible for cisplatin. So if patient is ineligible for cisplatin, we can use mitomycin. Disadvantages. There is 2 to 20% of genitourinary toxicity, 10% of GI toxicity, 10 to 20% of hematological complications, and approximately 2 to 3% end up in cystectomy for severe local symptoms later on. RP is most effective in patients with lower volume disease, that is clinical CT2, visibly complete transurethral resection. There is an absence of hydronephrosis and carcinoma in situ, small tumor size, solitary tumors, and hemoglobin level more than 10 gram per deciliter. There are different techniques of radiation therapy, either it can be external beam therapy or brachytherapy, and newer teletherapy like 3D conformal radiotherapy, intensity modulated radiotherapy, or image guided radiotherapy. Combination with chemotherapy. Combination treatment with chemotherapy plus radiation therapy has been shown to be effective in older patients with similar overall survival to most cystectomy series. Initial response to induction chemo radiation is approximately 70% in most patients. However, toxicity may be significant and 10 to 20% of patients will require delayed cystectomy because of invasive local recurrence or complications from radiation. There is another terminology, salvage cystectomy. Endoscopic salvage cystectomy is after we give radiation and then we re-evaluate endoscopically of patients after the 4 weeks of 40 gray of treatment. This may be a reasonable approach in an older patient who is still a good candidate. Salvage cystectomy after chemo radiation is feasible but has increased complications compared with the non-irradiated patients, and neobladder reconstruction only possible in selected patients. Coming to chemotherapy, current international guidelines recommend neoadjuvant chemotherapy for all T2 to T4A with no nodal or no metastasis. Chemotherapy is the treatment of choice in metastatic bladder cancer setting. Cisplatin-based chemotherapy is the preferred first-line treatment in metastatic bladder cancer, and patients should not be excluded only for their chronological age. Neoadjuvant chemotherapy has been shown to result a 5% absolute improvement in overall survival in patients undergoing cystectomy. It is particularly helpful in patients with hydronephrosis, lymphovascular invasion, a palpable mass under anesthesia, invasion of the prostate or uterus. Patients tolerate chemotherapy better before surgery than afterward. Hence, it is better to give neoadjuvant chemotherapy. In the patient who is not able to receive a standard cisplatin combination regimen, the decision between surgery alone versus neoadjuvant chemotherapy with an alternate regimen should be there, such as split dose cisplatin or gemcitabine plus carboplatin. We are aware about the exclusion criteria for treatment with cisplatin. Any of the following, that ECOG performance score more than equal to 2 or carnoscopy performance score 60 to 70%, creatinine clearance less than 60 ml per minute, peripheral neuropathy grade 2 or more, grade 2 or greater audiometric hearing loss, and NYHA class 3 or greater heart failure. These are some of the risk factors of chemotherapy toxicity in the elders. If the age is more than 72 years, GI or genitourinary toxicity, we are giving standard dosing of chemotherapy, the hemoglobin levels are less, the creatinine clearance is low, and there is hearing impairment, at least one fall in the last 6 months, limited in walking one block, need for assistance in taking medications, decreased social activity because of physical or emotional health. So these are the risk factors for chemotherapy toxicity in the elderly. A recent study of cisplatin-based combination chemotherapy in metastatic disease based on data from 8 phase 2 and phase 3 clinical trials with a total of 543 patients demonstrated no significant differences in the frequency of renal failure, febrile neutropenia, or treatment-related death or median survival for patients older and younger than 70 years of age. Coming to bladder preservation treatments, trimodal bladder preservation treatments with radical cystectomy as salvage therapy. Trimodal therapy in elderly patients has been found to be well tolerated with outcomes similar to that of radical cystectomy. Outcomes of trimodal therapy in patients more than equal to 75 years have been found to be comparable to those of younger patients. Criteria is there should be no nodal involvement, no invasion of adjacent organs, no disease near ureteral orifice or bladder trigone with hydronephrosis or carcinoma. Approximately 5 weeks of chemotherapy with radiotherapy, typically with either cisplatin or 5-fluorouracil or oblique mitomycin C, followed by repeat cystoscopy to assess the response with either salvage cystectomy for patients with residual invasive disease or completion of chemotherapy to approximately 60 to 65 gray for those with a complete response. It can be either a split course trimodal preservation or a continuous phase. There are different selected concurrent chemotherapy regimens for trimodality therapy. If the patient is contraindicated for cisplatin, so we have the gemcitabine with concurrent radiotherapy. We have carboplatin with concurrent radiotherapy. We have 5-fluorouracil mitomycin with concurrent radiotherapy. Some words about radical transurethral resection. A single modality treatment for T2 disease. There should be no hydronephrosis, no evidence of adenopathy. Tumor size should be less than 3 cm and lack of multifocal disease. Can be used as a monotherapy in T2 diseases. Future scopes, clinical trials, device-assisted therapies as electromotive drug administration, chemohyperthermia. Everolimus, which is a mammalian target of rapamycin inhibitor, exists in selected patients with metastatic bladder cancer. Immunotherapy with immune checkpoints, blockade of PD-L1 may be a therapeutic option for elderly bladder cancer patients. Given the overall tolerability and lack of significant toxicity of these agents based on studies, VEGF inhibitor therapy like bevacizumab or sunitinib, EGFR receptor therapy like cetuximab, trastuzumab, and lastly, fibroblast growth factor receptor therapy like BGJ398. So in the end, treatment of bladder cancer in the elderly. So suggested treatment options for patients with muscle invasive bladder cancer. Characteristic, medically operable, cisplatin eligible. So you can give neoadjuvant cisplatin based chemotherapy followed by radical cystectomy or trimodal therapy. The patient is medically operable, cisplatin ineligible. So you can go directly with radical cystectomy, radiation therapy with concurrent chemotherapy, but not cisplatin. Medically inoperable and cisplatin eligible, radiation therapy with concurrent cisplatin. Medically inoperable with cisplatin ineligible, radiation therapy with concurrent chemotherapy other than the cisplatin or radiation alone. Patients who are fit, these patients have no serious comorbidities and are functionally independent and have no malnutrition. This is sufficient for any form of standard treatment. Patients who are vulnerable, these patients are dependent in one or more daily living, but they present one or uncontrolled comorbid condition. Geriatric problems in this group are reversible with geriatric intervention. These patients may benefit from additional geriatric intervention and may receive standard cancer treatment after revision of the geriatric problems. Patients who are frail, these patients are dependent in one or more ADL, or that is activity of daily living, or have two uncontrolled comorbidities. Patient in this group should benefit from geriatric intervention and can be given specific adapted cancer treatment. And patients who are too sick, these patients have a very poor health status from a combination of different treatments. They only receive that is suitable for.
Hello. Hello? I think that was a very comprehensive and very well done presentation. Excellent. A lot of information there, and I think we really spent a lot of time in getting all the information. Although not everything is for over 80, but he just talked of elderly as the elderly. Elderly not in terms of chronological age, but elderly in terms of medical and other issues. So I think yeah, it's very, very important.